wondering what you got for me.
Egyptian cotton is hard to beat,
my lady on me. I'm wondering what you got for me.
Egyptian cotton is hard to beat,
my lady on me.
Disruptive innovation.
Yes.
You are, we got a lot of different speakers that are going to be there, right, from massive followings, everything they're doing, like yourself, just growing and building and that kind of stuff. But what does it mean to you, and do you see yourself as disrupting an industry or disrupting, and positive disruption, obviously, is what we're all going for. But like, when you think about it, what does it mean?
To be quite frank, it's only disruptive to the ones that are pushing back against it.
Wow.
Like, it's not, to me, it's not disruptive if you understand what's happening. It's only disruptive to the ones that are hanging on to the old school ways of doing things that's going away.
Just listen to this, man. On three, right, on the third honk. One, two, go.
Good job.
Yeah.
Impressive. Goodbye.
Yo, what up, guys? It's Gary Vee, and it's time for the Daily Bread.
Give us our daily bread. I want the whole basket, cause I'm a hustle till I get it or I'm in a casket. Passionate for providing value in every way, not cashing in for providing value every day. Paying it forward, right thing, I'll do it till I'm dead. I hope you're hungry, cause it's time for the Daily Bread.
What's up? So it's Saturday morning, Huntington Beach, California. We got a bunch of guys here that are going to be speaking at the Disruptive Innovation Disrupt Tour event June 1st at this resort. So we're getting a bunch of content filmed today, some intro, kind of highlight reel type stuff that'll play before the event, and also just kind of talking about the event in general. So excited to be here, beautiful resort. Do what? 238. Yeah. Yeah, it's good lighting today, good cloud coverage, so this resort's beautiful. Excited to meet some of these people. These are all of the people that are going to be speaking at the event, not everyone that will be speaking, but everyone here will be speaking, and so it's going to be pretty awesome. Got a bunch of stuff lined up today, so it's going to be a chaotic day. Gosh almighty, I'm sweating now. Woo!
We're the ones with, at that point, right?
All right.
People following you, like everyone else being like, they're the ones following.
Hey, so here's the idea. We're gonna get both cars, Cena's parked right here. Put like, I don't know, three in one, four in the other, something like that, right? Both roll up. They're gonna get footage of each door opening and like people getting out. So
then
we'll take a last take where we'll actually get out. And then the same thing I was talking about, you and Cena will lead.
Mm-hmm.
And then you guys can still do that whole like, kind of like,
yeah,
I'm gonna kill it, that thing. And then we'll all be like walking together. We'll come through here, we'll roll that way. But what we also need to figure out how to do is we gotta get the guests like off that wall and over here, because we can't put them in the film.
We'll be right back.
You know that feeling of being left behind? I really started feeling that way. I felt like I was missing the freaking boat. And so I really started stepping up my game and learning how to just be innovated instead of just like the same old. And because of that, my business has blown up. Do not miss the boat.
We're in a time where there's gonna be a world of new leaders and every industry has its moment. And right now, insurance and real estate, we're the ones that are taking over.
So. You don't wanna miss it because real estate and insurance is gonna come together to talk about the best practices when it comes to social media and how to take your success to a higher level.
15 years I've been in the insurance and real estate business, just came off the tour from Agent 2021, Gamma International's LAMP 2018, and I can't wait to bring to you new digital era marketing strategy.
Disruptive innovation, June 1st. If you have not gotten your ticket yet, it is single-handedly the biggest mistake that you are making fundamentally in your life. But we've got some incredible speakers here. I'm gonna be kicking off the event with the very first keynote of the day. But guys, take a look at this resort. It's absolutely beautiful. You gotta come out here. Huntington Beach, June 1st, here at the Paseo Hotel and Resort. Cannot wait to see you there. What is up, everybody? This is Tyler Harris, your host of the Breadwinner Podcast, and we are actually live right now at the Paseo, what is it, Hotel and Resort?
Hotel and Resort,
Hotel
Huntington Beach.
Hotel and Resort in Huntington Beach. We've been filming a bunch of content here this morning with a big crew. We've got a special guest here recording a podcast live on air. We've got Mr. Andy Dane Carter. I'm going to allow you, man. I don't want to even mess up your intro. Just tell everybody who you are, where you're from, kind of what your focus is on right now, and then we'll kind of go back and forth and go from there, man.
Sure, yeah. So my name is Andy Dane Carter, and I'm from Long Beach, California, born and raised. And I'm into real estate. I'm into real estate investing. Awesome. I'm into media. I'm into all the different spaces for digital growth. But my biggest thing right now is to really help people truly understand all of their options in real estate and real estate investing. And it's just a big part of my message.
Yeah.
And this book that I just wrote, it's called 100 Doors. It's only 100 pages. It takes 100 minutes to read. It gives you the blueprint on how to really kind of invest in real estate on the short term.
And so what's the 100 doors?
Right. So that's the concept that I came up with, was once you have a 100 doors, mm-hmm, that are all going to net you $1,000 a door in cash flow, okay, you're making $100,000 a month,
yep,
in passive income for doing nothing. Your tenants are 100% covering the cost, mortgage, taxes, yeah, and expenses.
It sounds terrible.
It's awful. But you can live on that.
Yeah, you can.
You can live
it's
on $100,000 a month.
It's, yeah, a good start.
It is.
Hey, so man, one question I love to ask people is, every successful person has a painful story. If you, mm-hmm, haven't heard it yet, it's just because it hadn't come out yet. Mm-hmm. But the part we'd like to add on to that is, will your painful story have a successful ending? So what's one of those stories that you have, one of those things that now looking back, you know happened for you, not to you, and has made you the business person or just the man that you are today?
Yeah, no, and it was actually put so beautifully by you. It didn't happen to me.
Exactly.
It happened for me. Mm-hmm. And it's the thing I say a lot, if you can survive the event, if you can live through the event,
yep,
then you can live with the memory. So if it happens to you,
yep,
and you can live with that, it didn't kill you,
yep,
then you can live with the memory. So for me, I was raised poor.
Okay.
Was raised poor, raised by a single mom.
Okay.
It was me and my brother and her. We lived in a one bedroom apartment. We lived out of a cooler.
Wow.
And we struggled. Like, yeah, we struggled. So I saw from a very young age that if I wanted something, I had to really go out and make it happen for myself.
That's awesome.
And that's one of the pain points for me, because I had to change that mindset. I had to unlock a new mindset as a kid to get something, or I'd have been stuck.
So let's kind of take it back a little, and what's been the progression? Like, what have been kind of the key steps along the way that have led to where you're at now? Like, how long have you been doing real estate?
I've been doing real estate for just about 10 years.
Okay.
And I had a totally different world before that.
Okay.
And a totally different world before that.
Got
so
it.
I've kind of gone in different phases, like, okay, most entrepreneurs,
sure, yeah,
and I go full gas. So yeah, I started working when I was 12, because I really wanted to buy a wetsuit. All my friends were rich. I wanted to surf in the summer, and I didn't have any money. So I started working. I was cleaning silk screens at the silk screen shop, only place in town to give me a job because I was too young.
Yeah.
And I would slowly give this guy $20 every time I got paid for my wetsuit.
That's awesome.
And I got it, and I was so accomplished. I was in tears.
Oh, absolutely.
That was it for me. So that set the fire. And then I was deep into restaurants for a long time, and I used to buy restaurants and stuff like that, which was great.
Okay.
But a big shifting part for me was when I was in the wine business. I became one of the youngest wine sommeliers in the country.
Really?
And I was 21, got super fired up on wine, but then got burnt out, was drinking like crazy, put on like 50 pounds, and I was working for corporate and not myself. Like, I was just burning the candle at both ends.
Yeah.
And so I hit pause. I didn't work for a year and a half.
Okay.
We got super into yoga.
Yeah.
And just got really healthy.
That's awesome. And so coming out of that, we said year and a half.
Literally doing nothing and spending my whole savings.
And so was that a big self-development? You said you were doing yoga, but was it a lot on the mental side of like building yourself back up, or just was it changing who you were, like transforming into someone new, or was it just like figuring out who you were?
It was exposing who I was.
Yeah.
It was literally cracking all the bullshit, all the ego, all the stories that I've been telling myself or that were told to me growing up, like, you're severely dyslexic, you're never going to do this.
Mm-hmm.
You're not that smart, you got terrible grades, D's and F's.
Yeah.
Like, that was constant in my life growing up.
Yeah.
And plus, I love just slapping people with, you're wrong. I'm gonna prove you wrong. Watch this.
Yeah. So, man, it's so similar to my story. I had probably a two-year period where I was still... I still had jobs, but I wasn't working.
Yes.
I was playing the victim, playing the blame game. All these things that had happened to me at that time, the way I looked at it, and was completely content with just like having people feel sorry for me for these things that had happened, and just not being able to go all in because I was fearful that if I went all in again, it would be taken away.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was just like this scapegoat. It was like, it was so easy for me to explain, oh, well, the reason I got terminated from that job or the reason I quit that job, well, I wasn't trying. I was like, oh, I wasn't trying. I mean, if I would have tried, I would have killed it. But, like, you know, I wasn't trying. So, of course, it didn't work out. And I used that for, like, two and a half years before finally having this realization, whether you call it personal responsibility or taking ownership, but just realizing that, like, everything that was happening, it was all my fault. Like, none of that stuff, like, I had to take ownership of all of it because... when you point the finger at someone else, you give them the power. And I'm
100%.
Huge on taking that power back by just owning every situation. Let's get a little bit more tactical here on just some of the key things that have helped you succeed. What I want to know is, what are some of the things that you quit doing that enabled you to succeed or enabled you to put you in a position to succeed?
It's a very, very good question. And so for me, it was a few things that I stopped doing.
Yeah.
But it was more so things that I made non-negotiables for me.
Mm-hmm.
So what I did is I took away the victim mentality.
Yep.
I took away the blame game, as I'm sure you know well, as I did.
Oh, yeah.
It wasn't my fault, it was theirs.
Mm-hmm.
Once I started taking vicious, wild accountability for everything I did and everything was my fault, I could move much faster. I could stay on the offense much longer. So when I started to do meditations every morning for 10 minutes, non-negotiable, no matter what, right after that, 5 minutes of sitting in gratitude. So I sit in gratitude, what I'm grateful for.
Yep.
What that does is it just gives me space for the day. I mean, I've got five companies. They're all on fire half the time. So if I'm not prepared, I'm in big trouble.
Yep.
So I didn't really stop doing as much except for blaming everybody. But I started to add more things like family. I make breakfast for my family every morning. For the nanny. And then I go to work. I work from 10 to 3.
Yep.
I work 3 o'clock every day for my kids.
That's awesome.
Like, so I stopped giving the excuse of it's all about the commas and the zeros.
Mm-hmm.
It's not just about the money in the bank.
Yeah.
And when I shifted that mindset, everything changed.
So it became more about the lifestyle. Because what is an extra comma worth if your lifestyle is terrible?
Or your health.
Yeah,
right?
Or your health. Yeah.
Right?
And I think so many people, I always kind of laugh at this idea of this work-life balance, because to me it's just going all in all areas.
It
seems like there's always something missing. Like, you go through these phases where everything's going incredible with your business, but you got out of shape. Or you go all in
or
at the gym.
Shredded, but not poor.
Yeah, exactly. Or the family stuff. Like, the thing that kind of cracks me up about this work-life balance is you never hear, people don't bring up work-life balance in relation to like needing to spend less time with their family. It's always brought up in some reason or excuse why they need to work less.
Yes.
It's always like, man, I've
I really need to start spending more time with my family. You know, this work-life balance is so huge. Right. So I'm going to work less. I'm like, right. You do realize there's two ways to balance a scale. Like,
100%.
You can take away, but you can also just add to the other side.
The most successful people don't take away, they add to. It's in addition. Exactly. And it's that whole thing that goes back to work-life balance is very singular.
Yeah.
It's very personal. And what works great for you absolutely. Probably wouldn't work for me and vice versa. So I had to really start to know myself, and it was important to me when I've got two amazing boys. They're 2 and 4.
Yep.
When they were born, I'm like, I'll be home at 3 o'clock.
Yeah.
I don't know how I'm going to create that yet.
Sure.
But I'm going to become that man and that business leader to make that happen.